I'm sure we all love to take a vacation to the past. I mean, who wouldn't want to, say, watch the pyramids get built? But before you embark on your time traveling escapades, you might want to bring a first aid kit, because trust me, where you're going, you won't be finding any band-aids. Ladies and gents, it's your boy AJ back with another most amazing top 10, and today I present to you the top 10 weird medical practices in history that you were never taught about. At number 10 is Radithor, radioactive water. Yep, you heard that right. Back as recently as the early 20th century, before we knew better, when radioactivity was all the rage, pun intended, some folks believed that ingesting radioactive substances could actually improve your health and cure just about anything. From arthritis to acne, heck, even a cure for impotence, cause why the heck not? It's the 1900s and ain't nobody gonna fact check you. It was like the superhero serum of the time. One particularly famous example was the Radithor, a radon-infused water tonic that was marketed as a health elixir. People chugged this stuff like it was going out of style, believing it would give them a boost of energy and vitality. But hold your horses, champ, because before you start searching for a bottle of Radithor on eBay, let's talk common sense derived from the benefit of hindsight. While it's true that some forms of radiation can be used for medical purposes today, the kind of radioactivity these historical treatments involved was a whole different story. Ingesting radioactive substances could lead to a host of health issues like tissue damage, cancer, and other not-so-fun side effects. If you're enjoying the video so far, you can support this channel by pressing like, subscribing to Most Amazing, and ringing that notification bell. And number 9 is mummy medicine. Back in the day, mummies were believed to possess mystical healing properties. From ancient Egypt to Europe's Renaissance period, people ground up these preserved bodies into powders or potions, thinking that they could cure anything from headaches to broken bones. Who would have thought that ancient Egyptian pharmacies would sell mummy juice? Now you might be wondering, why on earth would anyone think that ground up mummies could heal them? Well, it all came down to the concept of sympathetic magic. It was the idea that if you consumed a part of a mummy, which was considered to be timeless and preserved, you would gain some of its life force and longevity. Life force from an unalive thing. Yeah. Mummy medicine wasn't just ingested, it was also used topically. People would mix the mummy powder with various substances and apply it to wounds or injuries. It was believed to possess some mystical healing powers that could speed up the recovery process, but here's the kicker. They weren't just using any mummies. No, they had a hierarchy. You see, the best mummies were thought to come from executed criminals. And if you're wondering why, well, it was believed that the unfortunate life circumstances imbued them with extra potency. Plus, if you think that this was just an old world thing, think again, because mummy medicine managed to stick around until the early 20th century. So next time you visit a museum and see a mummy on display, just remember, that thing might have been a key ingredient in someone's headache remedy. Weird, right? At number 8, the electric eel pain relief. Oh boy. When it comes to finding relief from pain, humanity has been pretty creative, but have you ever heard of using electric eels for your pain? So picture this, it's way back in ancient Rome, and you're suffering from some nasty pain. I don't know, maybe you've been carrying bricks on your back all day for that new cathedral. Now you're in the midst of ancient history, my friends, so instead of popping an Advil or calling your family doctor, you find yourself a trusty electric eel. These eels with their electric charges were believed to possess mystical properties. The idea was that letting some of these aquatic shockers zap you, your pain would somehow just disappear. Now, it might seem like a bizarre way to handle pain, but as with everything the Romans did, there's a hint of logic behind it. You see, electric eels use electric shocks in the wild to navigate and hunt, and some folks thought that by harnessing this natural electric power, you could somehow overwhelm and reset your body's pain signals. Plus, who wouldn't want to be the first in line for a massage from a thunderfish, am I right? But of course, this practice raises more questions than it answers. Did it actually work? Was it safe? And more importantly, did the cure end up being worse than the ailment? Personally, I wouldn't want to test and find out. At number 7 is the smoke enema. Oh boy. Ah, smoke enemas. Quite a head turner when it comes to weird medical practices of the past. You see, throughout history, people have come up with some pretty creative ways to treat various ailments. And I mean, either creative or insane, but I'll let you decide that for yourself down in the comments. Now picture this. It's the 18th century and someone is experiencing, say, a near drowning incident. And what do you do? Well, according to medical practices at the time, the answer would be to introduce tobacco smoke into the rectum. Yeah, you heard me right, where the sun don't usually shine. The idea behind this was that the smoke would supposedly warm up the body and simulate respiration from your booty? This practice gained quite a following, and even a special gadget called the tobacco smoke enema apparatus was invented for this very purpose. It was basically a bellows connected with a tube that was inserted into the, well, where it shouldn't go, allowing for the smoke to be blown in. While the smoke enema might sound like the kind of quirky solution that would only come from a different era, it's important to note that it wasn't widely accepted or successful as some other treatments. Medical minds at the time eventually realized that this practice wasn't as effective as they had initially hoped, and gradually it went up in smoke, so to speak. At number 6, spider webs for wound dressing. Long ago, in a time before the wonders of modern medicine, people had to make do with what nature provided, and apparently, nature's architects, spiders, were considered quite the medical marvels. Now, the concept is surprisingly straightforward. When someone suffered a minor cut or wound, instead of reaching for the nearest bandage, which hadn't been invented yet, they would apply a spider web to the injury. Why, you might ask? Well, spider silk, as it turns out, possesses some rather unique properties. It's incredibly lightweight, yet remarkably strong, and is known for its ability to repel water. This made it an interesting choice for wound care, as the silk's fine structure could potentially create a barrier that kept out dirt and other contaminants while simultaneously still allowing the wound to breathe. But before you go on searching for spiders to create your own DIY wound dressing, let's acknowledge the downsides. Firstly, not all spider silk is created equal. Some spiders produce silk with potential antibacterial properties, while others might do the opposite. So on that note, there's the issue of sanitation. Let's just say those cobwebs you find in the attic might not be the most sterile choice to apply on your open wound. In the grand scheme of things, the idea of using a spider as wound dressings might be more of an interesting historical tidbit than a practical solution in today's world. Modern medicine has thankfully provided us with a plethora of sterile, advanced wound care options that leave the arachnids to their web-building pursuits. At number 5 is the tapeworm diet. Oh boy. Back in the early 20th century, some folks believed that having a tapeworm was the ultimate weight loss solution. The idea was that this unwelcome guest would munch away at your ingested goodies, leaving you slimmer without really cutting back on the snacks. But of course, reality rarely agrees with such bizarre notions. This diet often led to some malnutrition on account of the fact that you have a literal worm in your intestines absorbing all your nutrients for you. There's also the possibility of infection on account of the fact that you have a literal worm in your intestines pooping as it pleases, as well as a whole breadth of seriously unpleasant side effects. On account of the fact that you have a literal worm inside of your intestines, I mean, come on, you guys! Is it that hard to see why this is a problem? Not to mention that once you invited these freeloaders into your gut, getting them out is a whole new ordeal. So while tapping into a tapeworm might sound like the stuff of science fiction, it's a reminder that even in the pursuit of health and beauty, a little freaking common sense goes a long way. At number 4, the Roman times, a land of togas, gladiators, and ingesting urine? Oh god, it just keeps getting worse. The ancient Romans were known for their ingenuity, but they also had some rather peculiar medical practices hanging up their tunics. Pun not intended. Now don't be weird or anything, they weren't just consuming any urine. Only urine of certain individuals were said to hold magical healing properties. This practice, known as urotherapy, involved applying urine to wounds, gargling it for oral health care and teeth whitening, and using it as an ingredient in various remedies. Now, before you wrinkle your nose in disbelief, let's delve into the logic, or lack thereof. Romans believed that urine carried the secrets to a person's health. They would examine its color, taste, and even smell to diagnose illnesses. They had specific urinals for the purpose, designed to catch the precious liquid and let doctors perform their analysis with the seriousness of a modern day lab technician. But wait, it gets even weirder. Some Romans took this to a whole new level. See, Emperor Nero, for instance, reportedly used young boys' urine to keep his skin looking radiant. And if that wasn't enough, they even had manuals, yes, actual books, on the art of uroscopy, the skill of reading pee like it's some kind of mystical scroll. So the next time you raise an eyebrow to modern medicine, just remember, at least we're not doing that. The ancient Romans may have left us with some impressive architecture, but their medical advice? Oh boy. At number 3 is morphine. In the late 1800s, a new wonder drug emerged, morphine. Physicians hailed it as a magic wand against pain, disease, and discomfort. But here's the catch. While it might have provided temporary relief, it was far from a magic cure. Opium, as you may know, is highly addictive and can have some rather unpleasant side effects. So what began as a medical miracle turned into a nationwide nightmare. By 1895, the opiate addiction had gripped 1 in 200 Americans. The Civil War inadvertently launched an opiate epidemic, with the hypodermic syringe becoming a go-to temptation for both doctors and patients alike. The addiction crisis peaked in 1895, prompting a slow reversal. Advances in medicine, education, and regulation began to unshackle society from the opiate grip. Opium dens and smoking emerged, changing societal perceptions in the face of addiction. Laws evolved from regulation to prohibition to treatment, and the allure of quick relief reminds us to tread carefully. At number two, a practice that might just leave you scratching your head, trepanation, the ancient technique of drilling a hole into the skull. Now, before you wince too hard, let's explore why people would actually voluntarily undergo this procedure. Back in the day, trepanation was believed to treat a variety of ailments, from headaches to epilepsy to, well, letting out demons. Think of it as the let's let the bad stuff out approach to medicine, kind of like installing a pressure valve for your brain, but with more drilling and less engineering. Ancient civilizations like the Egyptians, the Greeks, and the Incas all had their take on this practice. They used a range of tools from flint to bronze to carefully bore holes into the noggin. But the question remains, did it work? Well, evidence suggests that some people actually survived this procedure, with archaeological finds showing evidence of healed skull openings, which is pretty impressive considering the tools and, you know, lack of modern medicine or any anesthesia whatsoever. But let's not kid ourselves, this was still a risky game of chance. But before you grab your drill and start, you know, thinking of a career change, let's remember that trepanation's scientific validity is, well, a bit holy. Like, these genes should be 50% off holy, not sew those genes up before you're late for church holy, just to clarify. At number one is maggot therapy, the worst one. Maggot therapy, also known as larval therapy, was a rather unconventional method used in the past for treating various ailments. Back in the day, doctors would intentionally introduce maggots onto wounds. Why, you ask? Well, as it turns out, these creepy crawlies had a peculiar talent. Maggots have an appetite for dead tissue. They munch away on the necrotic, infected parts of a wound, leaving the healthy tissue untouched. Kind of like a tiny cleanup crew crawling on your skin. The practice might seem bizarre to us now, but it had a surprisingly practical rationale. History records suggest that maggot therapy dates back to ancient times, with reports of its use in cultures like the Mayans and the Aboriginal peoples of Australia. However, it gained even more popularity during the 19th century, especially during times of war when infections and gangrene were rampant. But here's the twist. Maggot therapy has actually found a place in modern medicine too. In controlled and sterile environments, medical maggots, yup, medical maggots, are bred and used to actually clean wounds, promote healing, and prevent infections. These maggots are certified clean, not the ones you'd find in your backyard. So there you have it. Maggot therapy might give you the heebie-jeebies, but it's a prime example of how unconventional methods can sometimes lead to surprisingly medical breakthroughs. However, personally, I'd rather just perish. So after learning about all that, don't you feel a little lucky to exist in the present? Yeah, you know, on second thought, maybe a vacation to the future would be a safer idea. Just, you know, mind the alien plague. As always, if there's a medical practice you were never taught about that I've missed, which, I mean, now that I think about it, how would you know about a practice you were never made aware of? I digress. Feel free to let me know down in the comments. This has been AJ with Most Amazing, and I'll catch you all in another video.